Hi everyone, hi folks, this is Dr. Kiroj Chandra Panda back again to talk about topics related to otolaryngology and audiology. In this video, I am talking about masking, the need for masking, the importance of masking, masking rules and the interoral attenuation. Masking is one of the most important topics in clinical audiology and otolaryngology. I am sure bearing a few rest are still barking up the wrong tree. Therefore, the last mistake doesn't get the opportunity to become the best teacher. Since masking is the last topic, I would like to cover the entire topic comprising of 5 videos, and those videos will be uploaded in phases. Here we go. The test tone cross across the head by bone conduction and be heard by the cochlea in the non-test ear. To overcome this, we introduce masking noise to the non-test ear so that the non-test cochlea is unable to hear the tone. And this is what is the need for masking. So, need for masking. The test tone cross across the head by bone conduction and be heard by the cochlea in the non-test ear. To overcome this, we introduce masking noise to the non-test ear so that the non-test cochlea is unable to hear the tone. This is what is the need for masking. A full understanding of masking is essential in clinical audiology, as in many cases we will be unable to obtain accurate audiograms unless masking is properly applied. Now, masking depends on the interrelationship of 3 factors. Number 1, the intensity of the test tone. Number 2, the bone conduction threshold in the non-test ear. And number 3, the interoral attenuation. Now, the interoral attenuation refers to the intensity reduction across the skull when the test tone travels from the test ear to the non-test cochlea. And this interoral attenuation for air conduction testing varies from one frequency to another. Studies have also shown that this interoral attenuation varies from one subject to another. For air conduction testing, the interoral attenuation varies from 40 dB to 80 dB. That is, the crossover hearing may occur when the test tone is presented at 40 to 80 dB greater than the bone conduction
threshold in the non-test year. There are two important studies relating to the interoral attenuation in air condition testing. One study is that by Smith and Markites in 1981, and the other one is by Liden et al. In 1949. As you can see the results in the above studies, wherein the interoral attenuation varies from one frequency to another, and the interoral attenuation also varies from one subject to another. Since the interoral attenuation varies from one subject to another and from one frequency to another, we take the worst case and assume that the interoral attenuation for air conduction testing to be 40 dB. Guys, now in the above case, the left air conduction threshold must be masked because there is a 40 dB gap between the air conduction on the left and the bone conduction on the right. As the left air conduction response could be coming from the right cochlea, masking must be applied to the right ear and then the left air conduction threshold retested. Now the rule number one for masking, you should remember this. The rule number one is, for air conduction testing, masking should be applied whenever the air conduction response exceeds the bone conduction threshold in the non-test ear by 40 dB or more. You should remember this. For air conduction testing, masking should be applied whenever the air conduction response exceeds the bone conduction threshold in the non-test ear by 40 dB or more. I reiterate, exceeds the bone conduction threshold in the non-test ear. Hope the last part was clear to you. Now we'll go to the bone conduction testing. For bone conduction, the interoral attenuation varies from 0 dB to 20 dB. Like in the air conduction testing, the IA, that is the interoral attenuation, varies from 40 to 80 dB and we take the worst case and assume the IA to be 40 dB. Similarly, in the bone conduction testing, since the IA varies from one person to the other, and it varies from one frequency to another, we take the worst case and assume that the interoral attenuation for bone conduction testing is 0 dB. In the above case, the unmasked bone conduction threshold was obtained with the bone conductor on the left mastoid, but it could have been heard by the right cochlea. Therefore, masking must be applied to the right ear and the left bone conduction threshold retested. When deciding whether to mask bone conduction thresholds, it is helpful to remember, why do we carry out bone conduction testing? We do bone conduction testing in order to determine whether a loss is conductive or sensorineural. We therefore look at the difference between the air and bone conduction thresholds of the ear in question, that is the airborne gap in the test ear. Now, the rule number two in masking. For bone conduction testing, masking should be applied whenever the airborne gap in the test ear, this is important, airborne gap in the test ear, is 15 dB or more. In the above case, there is a 10 decibel airborne gap on the right and a 20 decibel airborne gap on the left. The left bone conduction response must therefore be masked, but we don't need to mask the right bone conduction response. We don't generally mask 10 dB airborne gaps for the following reasons. A 10 dB airborne gap is generally insignificant in terms of client's overall management and is something called as central masking, which we'll be covering in the next video. Thank you. Good on you. Guys, I would request you to kindly subscribe to my YouTube channel to learn more about audiology and otolaryngology. Thank you.